1906, a massive archive of Sir Isaac Newton's private manuscripts was put on sale after being kept from the public for more than 200 years.
Should we say three? Thank you, sir.
The famous economist, John Maynard Keynes, acquired 100 lots. For the next 6 years, Keynes worked on breaking the mysterious code in which many were written. These documents drew Keynes into a world inhabited by charlatans and magicians, the world of alchemy. Once Keynes decoded these documents, his view of Newton was shattered. He realized Britain's most famous scientist was also Britain's most knowledgeable alchemist.
Newton came to be thought of as the first and greatest of the modern age of scientists, a rationalist, one who taught us to think on the lines of cold and untinctured reason. I do not see him in that light. Newton was not the first of the age of reason. He was the last of the magicians.
The scientific genius was also revealed as a religious zealot who interpreted the violent imagery in the Bible as God's word, thought ancient temples hid the secrets of the universe, and believed he had found in the Bible the date when this corrupt world would end. The cover-up of the dark, heretical side of Sir Isaac Newton began soon after his death. At Newton's bedside during his final painful moments in 1727 were two men whose adulatory writings would start the process of turning this flawed genius into an unblemished hero. One was John Conduit, married to Newton's half-niece, and the other, William Stukeley, Newton's first biographer.
The pain rose to such a height that the bed under him and the very room shook with his agonies, to the wonder of those who were present.
Though the drops of sweat ran down his face, he never complained or cried out, nor showed the least signs of peevishness.
Over the coming years, two of Newton's passions, alchemy and religion, would be hidden. John Conduit published Newton's works, funded Newton's hugely expensive monument in Westminster Abbey, and spread Newtonian propaganda for the rest of his life.
One of the interesting things about the alchemical papers is that when Newton died, on the wrappers, the man who did the inventory wrote, "not fit to be printed," because they would have destroyed that image of Newton as the great natural philosopher, or as we would call the great scientist of his day.
The story of the hidden Newton begins when Isaac Newton returned to Trinity College, Cambridge, in 1667. He was only 25, yet he had lived through unparalleled political and social turmoil. Civil war, regicide, the plague, and the Great Fire of London. Newton had been sheltering from the plague for 2 years at his country home, but it was impossible to escape the religious fervor of the times.
As they look round the world through their providential eyeglasses, all they can see is plague, disorder, chaos, four riders of the apocalypse. Everything goes wrong. It's a time of absolute uncertainty, and probably for most people, clinging to their vision of God is the thing that gives them some continuity. People are convinced they're right, and that the people they're fighting are the agents of the devil and the Antichrist.
Newton had fervent Protestant beliefs.
He was actually intensely religious. And this is, of course, not the Newton of popular conception, but this is the Newton that we know from his personal manuscript. So he's intensely religious, he's intensely pious, and this Puritan ethic, this austere moral code, permeates his entire life.
He had been shaken by the decadence he had found at Cambridge when he first arrived in 1661.
It was a time, particularly after the restoration of Charles II, it was a time of great fun and frolicking. And I think Newton would have been dismayed by many of the antics of his fellow students. Drinking, going after bad young women in local villages.
In disgust, Newton later drew up his own plan for the education of youth in the universities.
All graduates, without exception, found by the proctors in taverns or other drinking houses, shall have their names given to your vice-chancellor, who shall summon them to answer for it before the next consistory.
Typically, Newton suggested devotion to study was the way to resist sexual temptation.
The way to chastity is not to struggle directly with incontinent thoughts, but to avert your thoughts by some employment, or by reading, or meditating on other things, or by converse. For he that's always thinking of chastity will be always thinking of women.
He's a very silent, thoughtful young man who, I suppose, looks as though he's utterly tedious from the outside. There's no evidence, I think, that anyone liked him at all, apart from his friend John Wickens.
Wickens and Newton started sharing chambers after both became depressed about being roomed with students who put pleasure before work.
They have a very peculiar relationship because Wickens is somebody who is of a higher status than Newton at Trinity, and seems to have become Newton's amanuensis, i.e. his secretary, over the following 20 years. But they must have been very close. They lived in the same rooms for 20 years.
Whether it involved a sexual component, we really don't know. But it was the longest-running friendship of Newton's life.
For two decades, from 1667, Newton would be cocooned in his own private world of study.
Truth is the offspring of silence and unbroken meditation.
He didn't go anywhere. I mean, he rarely traveled. He never went to the continent. He was that insular. I mean, he stayed in his rooms. He worked 7 days a week, 18 hours a day, and he pushed himself, drove himself. He had a library of his own that had about 1,600 or 1,800 volumes. But it was very much a world that came to him through printed matter or through manuscripts from others.
In the mid-1660s, Newton had made a bold decision.
I am a friend of Plato. I am a friend of Aristotle. But truth is my greater friend.
Newton had decided to search far beyond the narrow boundaries of the classical teachings for new truths about the universe. He devoured the philosophy of the fashionable French scholar René Descartes. In the early 17th century, Descartes depicted the universe as a giant clockwork machine created by God, but then left to run. At home during the plague years of 1665 and 1666, Newton had been intrigued by Descartes' mechanical philosophy. But he was suspicious of it. There was no role for God after the creation of the universe.
Whence is it that nature does nothing in vain? And whence arises all that order and beauty which we see in the world? Does it not appear from phenomena that there is a being, incorporeal, living, intelligent, omnipresent, who, in infinite space, as it were in his sensory, sees the things themselves intimately and thoroughly perceives them and comprehends them wholly?
This virtual recluse drove himself to test Descartes' theory. Was the universe really a mass of lifeless matter, or a living world run by God? He became fascinated by the force that held the moon in orbit and caused apples to fall. Surely gravity was a divine force, not a matter of chance. Newton was obsessive. In 18 months, he became the greatest mathematician in the world and invented calculus that enabled him to study the movements of planets in later years.
A feather or a black ribbon put between my eye and the setting sun makes great colors.
Descartes had said that light was created when a stream of particles hit the eye. Newton investigated whether light and color was created in the eye or by the brain, risking his eyesight time and again.
I took a bodkin and put it between my eye and the bone, as near to the back side of my eye as I could. And pressing my eye with the end of it, so as to make the curvature in my eye, there appeared several white, dark, and colored circles.
For centuries, philosophers from Aristotle to Descartes thought white light was pure and that colors were produced by modifying white light. Eventually, Newton turned this theory on its head. Using prisms, Newton proved white light is made up of primary colors, the colors of the rainbow. By the late 1660s, word of Newton's extraordinary scientific discoveries spread across Europe, but his religious inspiration was ignored.
Newton himself wanted to design a universe in which God was absolutely present and absolutely powerful. There's an enormous irony there. In the 18th century, gangs of interpreters, most of them French, will take the God out of Newton's world, and we will be left with a clockwork universe. I mean, it's a very common image of what the Newtonian world was, that it was soulless, that it was mechanical, that it was a piece of clockwork, that it really wasn't theologically motivated at all.
To this day, this purely mechanical picture of Newton's universe is still accepted worldwide. But in Jerusalem lies evidence of the scale of deception that has been perpetrated on generations. Dr. Stephen Snowbellen, an historian, has come to examine some of the 4,000 pages written by Newton that were sold at auction but not bought by the economist Maynard Keynes.
What these manuscripts reveal is a very different Newton than most people conceive of. A thinker who had a grand, unified project to uncover God's truth, God's true doctrines. This is a Newton who is not a cold, calculating scientist. This is revealing Newton in all his glory, warts and all, if you will. We see his theology, we see his science, we see his alchemy.
Alchemy was Newton's dark secret. For 25 years, from about 1668, Newton devoted himself to this illegal and clandestine practice. For centuries, alchemists had searched for the philosopher's stone, the mythical ingredient that transformed base metals into the purest gold. Thank you. Many fraudsters claim to possess it.
In some instances, it was immensely profitable. You could milk duke or prince of a substantial amount of money, no question. But if you got caught, it was extremely dangerous. We know that one of the customary punishments for defrocked alchemists, as it were, was to be hanged on a gilded scaffold. And sometimes they were forced to wear suits of tinsel as they were hanged to make it a public spectacle.
Newton secretly became one of Europe's leading alchemists.
These rules in general should be observed. First. Second, that the crucible be thoroughly heated before anything be put in. Third, the metals be put in successively, according to their degree of fusibility, iron, copper, antimony, tin, lead. Fourth, that they stand sometime after fusion before they be poured off according to the quantity of regulus they yield, iron, copper, tin, lead. Fifth, that no salt be thrown in unless upon iron to keep it from hardening. Sixth, that if you would have the saltpeter flow without too great a heat, you may quicken it by throwing a little saltpeter mixed with 1/8 or 1/16 of charcoal, finely powdered.
Why Newton took up the fraudulent practice of alchemy has baffled people for 300 years. He worked in strict secrecy. Even an assistant working with him did not know what Newton was seeing in the crucible.
What his aim might be, I was not able to penetrate into. But his pains, his diligence, those times made me think he aimed at something far beyond the reach of human art and industry.
Years later, when the economist Maynard Keynes gazed on Newton's private manuscripts, he was appalled. He assumed the great scientist appeared to be a magician, dabbling with the occult. Today, researchers are still trying to penetrate Newton's alchemical mind. At Indiana University in the United States, Professor Bill Newman has spent years deciphering Newton's coded recipes. He has redone experiments that Newton did 300 years ago. The task has been immense. Newton, like other alchemists, believed alchemical recipes were buried within ancient texts, from the Bible to Greek myths.
In some instances, he interprets the myths in a very, very exact way so that they correspond to actual recipes that you can carry out in the laboratory.
Professor Newman recreates a recipe that was derived from a myth found in the writings of the Roman poet Ovid. According to Isaac Newton, this recipe, called the net, should create a purple alloy that was one step towards discovering the Philosopher's Stone.
Behold, the net. It worked. A purple alloy with a striated net-like surface. It worked perfectly.
Newton, like all alchemists, concealed his ingredients in colorful riddles.
Our body, thus compounded, is called our hermaphrodite. Being of two sexes, and it is both father and mother to the stone.
Hermaphrodite refers to the regulus of antimony that you get by combining stibnite with iron at high temperature.
Newton uses codes like the green lion, the sordid whore, and the menstrual blood of the sordid whore to describe other metals. So what was Newton keeping concealed? Important clues have been found at King's College, Cambridge, where Newton's manuscripts, bought by the economist Maynard Keynes, are securely kept. Professor Rotanzi says Newton's own handwritten copy of an ancient alchemical treatise reveals the secret purpose of his alchemical quest.
This is the tabulus maragdina. The whole secret of the Philosopher's Stone is supposed to be concealed in this pretty short document.
But Professor Rotanzi says Newton was seeking the Philosopher's Stone not to become rich by turning metal into gold, but as part of his search for God's secrets.
The alchemists believed that this document not only described how God created the universe, it also enabled the alchemist to imitate the work of God. And by imitating the work of God, he could achieve miracles in nature. He's not a magician in the sense that he wants to master these forces so that he can use them to do marvelous things. It's ultimately to understand the mystery of and secrets of God's creation.
Newton believed God had handed down his secrets to disciples like Noah, and that they survived in fragmented form in scripture, ancient text, myths, and especially in alchemical literature.
He never loses faith in alchemy as concealing some of the greatest secrets of the universe, if you could decode them.
Newton felt he was specially chosen by God to decode them.
He writes his name in Latin, Isaacus Newtonus, and he plays around with the anagram and he turns it into Jehovah Sanctus Unus, one holy God. So there are already signs there of a fairly strong sense in the young Cambridge student that he's odd, that he's special, that he's picked out, that he is, to use the alchemical phrase, an adept, someone particularly equipped by the gift of grace, not only to pursue his studies, but to interpret the world.
Newton believed that through alchemy, he was finding God's secrets. This strange mix of what was called vulgar chemistry, myth and mystical imagery, helped form his unique perception of the world. Professor Newman believes one of Newton's basic experiments gave him an insight into the true nature of color.
Now, when Newton performs his optical experiments with the prism, it's quite possible that he was thinking of the prism as dividing up the white light into different types of particles, in much the same way as you're doing it when you distill the more subtle particles from the more gross ones.
Just when Newton was furtively immersing himself fully in the mysteries of the crucible, his earlier scientific achievements brought him worldly advancement.
But since I observe the geometers hitherto mistaken in a particular property of light that belongs to refractions, tacitly founding their demonstration on a certain physical hypothesis.
Aged just 26, he was made Lucasian professor of mathematics. Now he had to give lectures. But he had little time for students, and they had little interest in this incomprehensible, prudish professor. Years later, his assistant would record.
so few went to him, and fewer that understood him, that oftentimes he did, in a manner, for want of hearers, read to the wolves.
But Newton faced a terrible dilemma the day he had started to climb the academic ladder. He would be required to take holy orders and become a cleric in the Anglican Church. This set him on a collision course that threatened to end in his disgrace. He researched the history of Christianity and became convinced that both the Catholic and the Anglican Church were founded on a corruption of the Word of God.
Now, because Newton was so convinced that God is extremely powerful and unique, Newton, as the saying goes, reads himself into heresy. In other words, Newton begins to minimize, to play down, eventually to deny, the divinity of Christ.
And Newton comes to the conclusion very early on that the Trinity is a blasphemy on the first commandment, because the first commandment says that thou shalt have no other gods before me, and the worship of the Father, Son, and Holy Ghost, from Newton's point of view, is a heresy.
So by the early 1670s, Newton had become a secret heretic. He was convinced the doctrine of the Trinity, to which Henry VIII had dedicated Trinity College, was a form of blasphemy.
If Newton had been exposed while he was at Cambridge as an anti-Trinitarian, his career would have been over. He would have been ostracized. It's almost certain that it wouldn't have involved being put to death, but definitely prison would have been one possibility.
Newton would also have risked becoming a target for mobs of heretic hunters, often whipped into a frenzy by the clergy.
A heretic, like a witch, is a threat, not just to truth, but to you. It's a physical threat. It's going to compromise and corrupt the community. So very often, we know, from witch hunts, that the mob, the people, will take direct action against these sorts of individuals. People are lynched, people are kicked to death, they're burned.
The violence of the times is reflected in Newton's suppressed manuscripts. In these, he focuses his anger on the monks who corrupted Christianity by imposing the Trinity.
We can see page after page of material in which he tries to argue that the early church fathers, they're actually villains, they're criminals, and in some cases he actually calls them murderers for some of the things that they had done.
And they followed vanity and became vain.
When requested to give a lay sermon, Newton used the Bible to condemn the Catholic Church's use of idolatry.
And they left all the commandments of the Lord their God and made them molten images, even to calves, and made a grove, and worshipped all the host of heaven, and served Baal.
In the privacy of his rooms, Newton rejoiced in the torture of nuns he reads about in an ancient history book.
First he commanded, ye sacred nuns or virgins, to be assembled and searched by midwives, and then hung up with weights at their feet, and tortured with heated plates of iron applied to several parts of their bodies, saying, confess to us how ye bishops and priests lie with you.
Oh, he loves some of it, where tragically awful things happen to Roman Catholic nuns. You can hear Newton saying, good, the Antichrist is suffering. And I think we have to remember, for somebody like Newton, Roman Catholics aren't really human. They're compromised by the Antichrist. It's the same sort of argument that allows Cromwell to slaughter tens of thousands of Roman Catholic peasants. They're not really human.
Newton studied biblical texts obsessively. He had 30 Bibles in many languages, including Arabic and Hebrew. The books of prophecy, Daniel and Revelation, were his favorite texts, although they were often dismissed for their violent symbolism. Newton felt these contained, in code, the words of God and a description of past and future events. From his reading of Revelation, Newton became convinced God foresaw that the Catholics would corrupt pure Christianity.
I saw a woman sit upon a scarlet-colored beast, full of names of blasphemy, having 7 heads and 10 horns. And the woman was arrayed in purple and scarlet color, and decked with gold and precious stones and pearls, having a golden cup in her hand, full of abominations and filthiness of fornication. And upon her forehead was a name written: Mystery, Babylon the Great, mother of harlots and abominations of the earth.
This is a very powerful imagery. Newton associated the Catholic Church with a form of fornication. This was spiritual fornication, because if one imagines the pure church as a chaste virgin, then it makes sense to think in terms of the Catholic Church, the Trinitarian Church, as a harlot who had committed fornication with corrupt, non-biblical teachings. And it reveals a passionate hatred.
Just as Newton looked into the books of prophecy to see God's plans unfolding, so he looked into his alchemical crucible to find God's laws of the universe. Today, Professor Newman can see what Newton saw 300 years ago. Metals seem to come to life and grow like plants. In a secret, unpublished manuscript on the vegetation of metals, Newton gave an alchemical view of the universe.
His manuscript on vegetation begins with a discussion of metallic trees, and from that he then launches into a long exposé of the theory that the earth is alive and that it respires, exhales, inhales.
Newton said an almost magical ingredient called sal nitrum made the earth into a living being. He believed sal nitrum continually circulated from the stars to the fiery core of the earth, bringing life to the metals he saw in his flask and feeding plants.
This earth resembles a great animal, or rather, inanimate vegetable, draws in ethereal breath for its daily refreshment and vital ferment, and transpires with gross exhalations.
Newton even uses this unproven alchemical theory to explain the cause of gravity.
It comes down exceedingly rapidly as this very, very fine material that's completely imperceptible to our senses. But, and this is the key thing, this is responsible for bodies falling to the surface of the earth. In other words, it's a mechanism, a mechanical explanation of gravity.
Today, this experiment causes no surprise and certainly doesn't help to explain the mechanical cause of gravity. It's just the reaction of a metal compound in a silicate solution. But Newton's alchemy convinced him the hand of God influenced all things. Even tiny particles seemed to live and grow in his crucible. He mocked scientists like Descartes, who saw an inert, godless world.
were men and beasts made by fortuitous jumblings of atoms. There'd be many parts useless in them. Here a lump of flesh, there a member too much. Some kinds of beasts might have had but one eye, some more than two. Atoms, mechanical laws, are nothing when compared to the knowledge and wisdom of the Creator.
In 1675, Isaac Newton emerged from the womb of Trinity. His double life was in danger of being revealed. He could no longer put off the obligation as a professor to become a cleric, but that was against his heretical beliefs. So he set off to London to convince King Charles II to excuse him from taking holy orders. After seeing the king's advisors, Newton attended his first meeting of the Royal Society, the leading scientific body. Newton was just 33, but most members of the society held him in awe. He was delighted by his reception, and he agreed to send to the Royal Society a revolutionary paper he had written called An Hypothesis Explaining the Properties of Light. Later that year, over 4 weeks, Newton's work was read to the Royal Society. The author stayed in his laboratory.
Observation of flame and vital motions. For nature is a perpetual circulatory worker, generating fluids out of solids and solids out of fluids, fixed things out of volatile and volatile out of fixed, subtle out of gross and gross out of subtle.
The eminent members of the Royal Society must have been puzzled by the alchemical language that mirrored Newton's secret manuscript on the vegetation of metals.
Very thinly and subtly diffused through it. Perhaps of an unctuous or gummy, tenacious and springy nature.
Newton's hidden alchemy seemed to be giving new insights into science and also into God's way. And Newton was elated. He'd heard the news he'd been waiting for. King Charles II had exempted him from taking holy orders without knowing he was excusing a heretic. For the moment, Newton was safe. But he would be tormented for the rest of his life. Should he stay silent or denounce the corruption of the Anglican Church publicly?
If the Trinity is still here, so is the Antichrist. It's not something you can just sort of shrug off and say, oh, I'll deal with that tomorrow. It's not something that goes away when you go to sleep. It's going to haunt your dream.
Newton could reassure himself that he was doing God's will. His grand project was to understand all God's secrets of the creation, of the forces that held the universe together, and of God's plans for the second coming of Christ and the return to pure Christianity. As an adept, Newton believed that he was chosen to decode the secrets locked in the work of the ancients.
He was rediscovering what a select few who had been chosen by God to share these secrets had done in the past. And he ultimately becomes convinced that he is in fact special. He has the special confidence of God.
Newton thought ancient temples also held secrets only chosen people like himself could unravel. He was fascinated by King Solomon's temple that once stood above the Wailing Wall in Jerusalem. Newton saw the design of the temple encoded in the Bible, and he spent years attempting to break this code.
For Newton, the scenes of the Book of Revelation take place in the heavenly temple. And so in order to understand the Book of Revelation, in order to interpret the symbols, he needed to understand what the temple looked like.
The temple could even reveal the date when this corrupt world would end in the apocalypse and true Christianity would be reborn.
It was for him the object of some of his prophetic hopes, because he believed the temple was going to be rebuilt, reestablished in Jerusalem when Christ returned. So this was a part of his prophetic hope. He believed this was going to happen.
Newton thought the temple would also increase his scientific knowledge.
He believed that the Temple of Solomon was a literal blueprint for the secrets of the universe, its orientation, its size. He redrew it. He did fundamental mathematical calculations on it to understand and plumb the universe at large, and in essence, the mind of God.
In England, near Salisbury, there's a piece of antiquity called Stonehenge, which seems to be an ancient temple, for it is an area compassed circularly with two rows of very great stones, with passages on all sides for people to go in and out at.
Newton only visited Stonehenge in his imagination, but he was sure it also revealed the wisdom of the ancients.
He told this story that in ancient times, people knew that the sun was in the middle of the world, the planets orbit the sun, there was a force of gravity between the planets and the sun, and Newton said the ancients knew that. Okay, now how did he know that the ancients knew these things? Well, one sign was that the ancients built buildings which symbolized the solar system, that the ancient temples had fires in the middle, which stood for the sun. So he understood Stonehenge as an image of the solar system, with its central fire and then the Sarsen stones as a series of concentric rings standing for the orbits of the planets.
He could imagine priests walking around Stonehenge, chanting various songs, carrying on the Vestal religion, which was the religion that presumably God gave to Adam. Newton is reading in his views into Stonehenge, you know, that there is no remnants of a fire at the middle of Stonehenge. I think Newton treats the evidence of Stonehenge in the same way that he treats most other pieces of evidence. He has a hunch, and he ruthlessly crunches evidence to make it fit his own case. Whether it's science or looking at the ancient religion, he's like a brilliant lawyer.
In 1684, Edmund Halley, a young astronomer, asked Newton a question that would refocus his scientific genius on gravity, the mysterious force that binds the universe together.
Truly remarkable invention.
Thank you.
Mirror requires work.
My question is this. What kind of curve would be described by the planets? Supposing the force of the attraction toward the sun to be reciprocal to the square of the distance from it.
An ellipse.
An ellipse? How do you know?
I've done the calculation.
You have? How did you calculate it?
I'll show you.
Should be here somewhere.
Halley's question would change science forever. It caused Newton 3 years' frenzied work.
Don't worry, I will redo the calculations. I'll send you a copy.
Some months later, Halley received a short tract on the motion of planets in orbit. In his hand, Halley had the seeds of Newton's The Principia Mathematica, published in 1687.
It is the greatest book of science ever written, bar none. It is the most magnificent work. It is the most all-encompassing work. It is the most daring book of any scientific treatise ever written.
In the Principia, Newton spelt out the laws of motion, but his greatest achievement was the universal law of gravity.
This is saying that something on one end of the universe, billions of miles away, actually exerts an attraction through all the intervening material on one tiny particle on the other side of the universe. That is an extraordinary thought. And in my view, and the view of everybody else who's looked at it, there is simply nothing like that in physics up to that point. Nothing at all.
But deep within the pages of the Principia, especially in the later editions, researchers have discovered clues that show the hidden Newton, the passionate alchemist. Professor Newman has found evidence that Newton gave an alchemical explanation for gravity when describing the role of comets.
As far as the natural world went, he did have a unified vision. And even in the Principia, we find the Salnitrum, the niter theory, where he says that the tails of comets sink down to the Earth and then are somehow buoyed back up into the outer reaches of space and eventually serve as the food of the sun that allows it to continue to burn. So he was thinking in terms of this circulation theory even at the time of composing and revising the Principia.
Newton also believed comets were instruments of God's wrath, devastating weapons that would wipe out the corrupt world and bring the apocalypse as foretold in the Bible. He searched the Bible for the dates when the earth would end in a fiery maelstrom and for Christ's return to usher in 1,000 years of pure Christianity. The 1687 edition of the Principia only contains one reference to God as creator. But in later editions, Newton stressed the all-powerful role of God in his universe.
The most beautiful system of the sun, planets, and comets could only proceed from the counsel and dominion of an intelligent and powerful being. God therefore place the planets at different distances from the sun, so that according to their degrees of density, they may enjoy a greater or lesser proportion of the sun's heat.
When Newton was at the height of his fame, he was driven by his hatred of Catholics to oppose the Catholic King James II. He came up against notorious Judge Jeffreys, the Lord Chancellor, known as the Hanging Judge for his brutality. He was up against the king because a Catholic was handed a degree at the university, at a time when all Catholics were barred.
A mixture of Papists and Protestants in the same university can neither subsist happily nor long together.
It was a risky strategy.
And if the fountains want to be dried up,
that if one appeared in front of the Lord Chancellor, one was certainly going to risk at least a tongue lashing and probably something much worse.
Gentlemen, I will say to you what the scriptures say. Go your way and sin no more, lest a worse fate befalls thee.
Newton lost his battle, but the very next year the Catholic king was forced to flee the country. Newton the alchemist and secret heretic was catapulted into public life. He was elected an MP for Cambridge. but the lure of the crucible kept him chained to his furnace. Finally, in 1693, God's ultimate secret seemed tantalizingly within his reach. He watched, transfixed, as gold mixed with a special mercury seemed to swell before his eyes. Was this the Philosopher's Stone? He tried the experiment again and again, but he was wrong. The experiments had failed.
He realized that this was the end of the struggle. I think there's no question that he was disappointed, because he was looking for ultimate answers to questions, and he had failed in alchemy as he had not failed in any other pursuit.
There were other tensions. Newton had grown very close to a brilliant young mathematician and alchemist, Nicola Fatio de Duilier.
Pray, let me know by line or two whether you can have lodgings for us both in the same house at present, or whether you would have me take some other lodgings.
I am yours, most affectionately to serve you.
But in 1692, Fatio, a hypochondriac, wrote to tell Newton that he was dying.
I last night received your letter, with which how much I was affected, I cannot express. Pray, procure the advice and assistance of physicians before it be too late. And if you want any money, I will supply you. Sir, with my prayers for your recovery, I rest your most affectionate and faithful friend to serve you.
I doubt that Newton had a physical relationship with Fatio. But it's quite clear from the correspondence between them that these caused Newton to become emotionally disturbed.
Fatio lived, but a year later this relationship disintegrated. Newton then had a breakdown, accusing his few friends of misdeeds of which they were entirely innocent. He wrote to the diarist Samuel Pepys, president of the Royal Society.
I'm extremely troubled at the embroilment I am in, and have not slept well this 12-month, nor have my former consistency of mind. I never designed to get anything by your interest, nor by King James's favour, but am now sensible that I must withdraw from your acquaintance, and see neither you nor my great friends any more.
Newton also wrote an even more vicious letter to his friend, John Locke. Newton accused him of trying to
embroil me with women.
And when told Locke was ill, wrote,
'Twere better if you were dead.
Newton's friends forgave him, and he explained that he had been sick and had not slept for 5 nights.
He was knackered. And the reason he was knackered is because he'd spent the last 10 years, between, say, the early 1680s and the early 1690s, working all the hours that God sent, and it was Newton who thought that these were hours sent by God. If he had a breakdown, I think it was probably because of exhaustion.
Newton also had to cope both with his emotional crisis over Fatio and his failure to grasp the golden prize alchemy once promised. And all the time, there was the haunting fear of being exposed as a heretic. But he recovered and began a new life. He moved permanently from the cloisters of Trinity to London. Newton now sought and gained money and power. He became president of the Royal Society and master of the Royal Mint, where he earned a fortune. But all the time, he guarded his dark secret.
Right up to his death in 1727, he tried to keep his heresy as secret as possible, because the vast majority of people around him are Orthodox Anglicans. And he thinks, there's no point trying to convince these people of what I'm doing, because the time is not right. These people aren't fit to receive the kind of word that I'm giving out.
As he lay dying, Sir Isaac Newton, aged 84, finally revealed his double life. He made clear to startled friends the dangerous heretical belief that he had kept secret for 50 years. He refused to take the last sacrament.
Sir Isaac, that was a time of the last sacrament.
No. I will not die in the embrace of a corrupt church. I have made my peace with God.
Newton had accomplished more than any scientist before him. But some of his achievements lay undiscovered in his hidden manuscripts. All his life, Newton had worked feverishly to uncover God's plans. In Jerusalem, where Newton was convinced Christ would one day return to destroy corruption and usher in 1,000 years of peace and pure Christianity, Stephen Snowballen has unearthed a remarkable document. This shows that late in life, Newton decoded from the Bible the date he believed would see the beginning of the end of the world, the apocalypse.
A manuscript like this really brings to life that Newton was a deeply religious man, more like a fundamentalist in many ways than many of us would like to think. What he was trying to do is determine when the end would come, when Christ would return, when all the apocalyptic events of the end times would come to a head.
The date for all the violence predicted in the Book of Revelation. The date Newton prophesied for the apocalypse sits in our century, 2060.